On this edition of In the Life,
loving spouses discover they are legal strangers.
And then he lays on me, but you can't sue because you're not a spouse.
That old-time religion with the twist. And behind the scenes of Hairspray with In the Life's favorite mom.
This telephone call came. They're doing a musical of Hairspray, and they want to see me.
All this and more on In the Life, the gay and lesbian news magazine.
In the Life is funded in part by the H. Van Ameringen Foundation. Additional support provided by the Ford Foundation, the Gill Foundation, the Arcus Foundation, Nebraska AIDS Project, the Pride Foundation, University of Nebraska Medical Center HIV Clinic, the Terry K. Watanabe Charitable Trust, Michael A. Leppin, Orlando Reese and Bill Becker, William J. Resnick, the Jim Stepp and Peter Zimmer Funds of Stonewall Community Foundation, and the annual support of In the Life members like you.
Welcome to the season premiere of In the Life. I'm John Bartlett. America's gay and lesbian news magazine begins its 11th year in public television with a collection of stories about individuals who have refused to allow other people to define their identities, to set the terms of their relationships, or to deny them their religion. In the process, they've also found ways to transform their struggles into art, into community, and into an ever-evolving celebration. Tonight, Arthur Dong questions the fundamentals of family.
What pushes me forward in all my work is the questioning. The questioning of the construction of this contempt we have for homosexuality in our society.
Dance diva Joy Cardwell travels out and about.
50 years of Bill T. Jones, the artist.
Flags of many colors from over 70 countries will join the rainbow flag in Sydney, Australia.
I want to be able to protect Marcy throughout the rest of our lives the same way any other couple does.
And before Harvey Fierstein waxes philosophical, Daniel Carslake follows him all the way to Broadway.
Hey mama, welcome to the 60s. Oh, 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 oh. Oh mama, welcome to the 60s. Oh, 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 oh.
But tonight's show starts in California, where Jonathan Capehart revisits a horrific tragedy, one which led a woman to challenge the system that classifies gay and lesbian couples as legal strangers.
Last year, the death by dog mauling of a 33-year-old California woman and the subsequent trial made front page news across the country. But the landmark legal battle by the victim's surviving partner, which changed the law for gay and lesbian Californians, received minimal coverage. While Sharon Smith showed us that laws can be changed, her experience also points out what little protection our legal system extends to same-sex partnerships.
Mr. Noel, you have been charged with involuntary manslaughter of Diane Whipple.
My dog went nuts.
I'm in shock. We're all in shock right now.
The jury find the defendant, Marjorie Noler, guilty.
I remember being astonished and sickened at the story because adults just don't die in dog maulings.
It was a story that shocked the country.
I want to make sure that these guys pay for their crime.
But for Sharon Smith, it was more than just a news headline. It was an event that took away her spouse. Diane's death was a horrible loss for Sharon, but it led her on a single-minded fight for legal recognition of their relationship. That fight revealed how important it is for gay and lesbian couples to create domestic partnership paperwork.
Creation of a domestic partnership is the closest that a gay and lesbian couple, gay or lesbian couple, can come to approximating the status of marriage.
For Sharon and Diane, their relationship began the night they met in Southern California in 1994.
It was just energy as soon as I met her. It was just, there was kind of instant energy there.
They spent the next 7 years creating a life together.
She took life completely different than I did. She knew it was just about friends and family.
When Sharon's job took them to San Francisco, They chose a neighborhood overlooking the Golden Gate Bridge called Pacific Heights.
We lucked out when we got the apartment, so we thought.
Diane took a job coaching the women's lacrosse team at a nearby college. Things seemed perfect except for the neighbors down the hall, Robert Noel and Marjorie Noller, and their two large dogs, Dane and Hera.
The dogs were something that we were always aware of, but just like Noel and Noller, we didn't know their names, so we just said those people and those dogs.
But mostly their attention was on each other, not the dogs.
You know, we had dreams and, you know, we were making plans.
Those plans were shattered on January 26th, 2001.
The day it happened, it was a Friday.
Diane was bringing groceries into the house, and her neighbor down the corridor in the apartment building, Marjorie Noller, was walking two Presa Canario dogs.
One of the dogs lunged at Diane.
And they literally went after her, and unfortunately, they got to her, then took out a good portion of her throat.
So I'm on the phone, talking to my mom. As I approach the block where we lived, I'm describing the scene to my mom, everything. I'm counting police cars, there was two ambulances, there was fire engine, and I'm telling her all of this. And I look ahead and I see my landlord. And I run up to her and she looks at me, white as a ghost, and she said, oh my God, she got bit. Alita said, we need to take you to the hospital right now. And I said, well, now how bad is this? There's silence. And then finally somebody says, well, she's in critical condition. We get there to the hospital, we're in the emergency room, and they sit me down. When the surgeon is telling me, you need to focus. And that's when he said that she'd lost almost all her blood in the hallway. And then I see her and it wasn't her. They pretty much covered her up for me and, you know, except for her face. And there was just so much damage. It didn't even register it was her. But I knew that, you know, she had enough strength just to stay alive, just so I could say goodbye. Because she knows that, or knew that I would need to do that.
Diane Alexis Whipple passed away later that night, and Sharon's nightmare got even uglier as the dog's owners began speaking to the media.
They blamed Diane, basically. They said, you know, she could have gotten into the apartment. She should have gotten back into the apartment.
I had no knowledge that he would do anything like that. I mean, how can you prevent something you don't know is going to happen?
Sharon went to see an attorney, Michael Cordoza, hoping to get help sending the dog's owners to jail. What she didn't understand was that the victim has very little say in a criminal prosecution. But there was another alternative.
And I said, Sharon, when one spouse loses another spouse in a negligent situation, the other spouse can sue for wrongful death. It's like a monetary apology from the person who caused the negligence.
I thought, okay, well, that sounds good. This is my way of feeling like I'm going to hold them accountable.
But unfortunately, you're not married in the eyes of California.
And then he lays on me, but you can't sue because you're not a spouse. And then I'm thinking, this is ridiculous.
I could see tears welling up in her eyes. She said, that's not fair. Why? I loved her as much, if not more, than any heterosexual couple. Why?
And that's when I said to him, you know, well, what do I need to do? He said, well, you'd have to change the law. I said, okay, well, let's change the law.
The criminal case was about justice for Diane. The civil case is about justice for the relationship between Sharon and Diane.
As the dog's owners went on trial for Diane's death, Sharon and her lawyer went forward with the civil case, a wrongful death lawsuit. They asked the National Center for Lesbian Rights to come on as co-counsel.
Up until Sharon's case, never in this country had a same-sex surviving spouse been able to sue for wrongful death.
Without showing that Diane was her life partner, Sharon could not even begin her case.
The thing that was helpful for Sharon Smith was that at least she had a will that was created by her now lost partner that said, this is the person I want to have get everything. And that was at least enough to get her through the courthouse door.
Not only did Diane leave a will, but Sharon had registered her as a domestic partner for work benefits. This proved their status as domestic partners, but still did not ensure them the same rights as married couples.
In the absence of wills and so forth, the relationship is simply not recognizable. It's presumed to be a casual relationship, and you are considered to be what's called legal strangers.
The dog's owners asked the court to throw the case out on the grounds that a lesbian partner has no right to bring a wrongful death claim. Sharon worried about her chances of getting a conservative judge to decide in her favor.
The judge says, let's just say hypothetically, I agree with you. And I remember thinking, oh my God, there's no way, it's gonna happen.
But to her surprise, the judge refused to dismiss the case. He ruled that under the state constitution, Sharon was Diane's spouse. It was a landmark legal ruling.
The judge expanded the definition of spouse in California. He said, spouse means same-sex spouse.
This case is for the first time recognizing a domestic partner as a family member who has a right to recompense for her loss.
That was the first victory. The next goal was to change the law so that every gay couple in California would have this same right. Fortunately, openly lesbian assemblywoman Carol Migden was already sponsoring a bill in the state legislature to protect domestic partnerships. It was called AB 25.
This was a bill that was vetoed in 1998. It came up in 99. It came up in 2000.
When it came up again in 2001, Assemblywoman Migden asked for Sharon's help.
She came to Sacramento and testified on behalf of the bill and, you know, helped put a face on a horrific, tragic circumstance and lent dignity to the proceeding.
AB 25 passed, and in January 2002, it became law in California.
Sharon's story, her face attached to AB 25, we knew it would make all the difference, and I think there's no doubt that it did.
But not every couple has paperwork that can help them fight for the relationship. This was the case in Florida when Frank Gagliano lost his partner Rob Pierce in a news helicopter crash. Rob left no will, and the house they shared was in his name. 2 days after the memorial, Rob's family locked Frank out of the house.
In the absence of any paperwork, you have as much legal right as if your roommate or your best friend died.
It takes several documents to help protect a domestic partnership.
The most basic and obvious are wills, powers of attorney, healthcare proxies, having both people shown on a lease if they live in an apartment or on the deed if they both own a home.
If a tragedy hits, these documents may be the only way to preserve a partner's rights. In Sharon's case, they made it possible for her to carry out Diane's legacy.
I have forced myself to stay focused on what is this all about? And it's all about her.
In 1974, Kathy Kosachenko won a seat on the Ann Arbor, Michigan City Council and became the first openly gay candidate elected to public office in America. I'm Dan Butler, and you're watching In the Life.
Religion poses some serious concerns in the struggle for LGBT equality, and houses of worship play the central role in our next two stories. While religion threatens to divide the families in filmmaker Arthur Dong's documentary, Family Fundamentals, it also lays a foundation for the very vital communities featured in Centers of Faith.
When I delve into a film, it has to resonate in larger social issues and political issues. Although I often deal with these issues by looking at personal stories and see how it plays out in personal private lives.
In his critically acclaimed film, Coming Out Under Fire, Dong examines the military's policies on gay service members by recounting the stories of gay veterans.
I liked the military life. I liked the discipline, I liked the order, I liked the propaganda, the marching in the tombs. I really liked that. But I think my experience was not so positive. It threatened my love life. It threatened my very strong feelings toward another person. And it was not all right to fall in love with a woman.
And they took me to the Section 8 ward, which I'd heard about. You heard of, and that's where they sent lunatics. And I was assigned a bed, and they took all my clothes away. And I was given a pair of gray pajamas and a maroon robe and straw slippers. I was frightened and ashamed and humiliated and very alone.
It took away what power that I thought I had. It broke my spirit.
What pushes me forward in all my work is the questioning. The questioning of the construction of this contempt we have for homosexuality in our society. You know, where does it come from?
To look for answers to that question, Dong chose to further examine how homophobic attitudes turn into violence in his 1997 film, License to Kill, which profiles seven men convicted of murdering gays. Having narrowly escaped a gay bashing himself in 1977, Dong set out to ask the convicted murderers why they targeted homosexuals.
The homosexuals make themselves easy targets because the way they go out, they're basically out in different areas. It don't matter what city you go to, you can find them in the parks. If you can walk into a 7-Eleven and rob a 7-Eleven for 15, 20 bucks, get your face on videotape, have somebody that's got to call the police. Or if you can go to a park, rob somebody that's out in the dark, come away with a hell of a lot more, take their car, get a nice system. Because of the fact they're a homosexual and they don't want people to know it, they're not going to go report it to the police. Who are you going to go rob?
They was trying to sink into our heads then when we were kids that what's written in the Bible's right. Nothing else is, you know. Well, if you read it in the Bible, then you can believe it. So that's just really where it was coming from about church, you know. But that's just pretty much where I carried it from, you know. If I can read it in the Bible, I know it's right.
In his latest film, Family Fundamentals, Dong takes a more in-depth look at the conservative Christians who use the Bible to condemn homosexuality. He takes us into the private lives of three families with parents who actively oppose homosexuality, despite having gay kids themselves.
I chose to make Family Fundamentals by, in terms of looking at specific families as a way to really explore larger issues and debates over homosexuality in this country. And each one of them represent sort of a different look at the debate. One family is a political family. One family is involved in reparative therapy. And a third family has, as one of the parents, a leader of a church.
Kathleen Bremner started the San Diego Spatula Ministries in response to her daughter's coming out. Currently, she conducts monthly support group meetings for parents with children who have come out.
This is the way they look right now.
Susan and David.
Uh-huh. That's her son.
And he's gay.
Yeah.
My mother doesn't know her daughter or her grandson. She doesn't know either one of us as people or what we're about.
The Bible is and says that homosexuality is a sin. And it's wrong, and it is not, it's a destructive behavior. It will not bring happiness. It says that very clearly, and it's just wrong.
All of this is all about her, not about us, you know. It's what she wants and what she thinks.
I think with Susan and Kathleen, you know, you have this, gosh, decades relationship, you know, pulling back and forth. And I believe that the parent-child relationship is there on a certain level, and you can't disconnect that no matter how much you disagree.
I guess we're gonna just have to agree to disagree because no matter what she says, she's still my mom. You only have one. I still love her. I don't agree with her, and I'm so sorry that she's really the one missing the boat, because she's missed out on 25 years of having a really great relationship with her daughter.
The film also profiles Brian Bennett, the gay former chief of staff to conservative Republican Congressman Bob Dornan, and Brett Matthews, the son of a Mormon bishop. Both share some of the same struggles with their family's religious views that Susan does with hers.
I wanted to be accepted in the Mormon church. I wanted to be viewed as a good person, a righteous person. Somebody that was going to go to heaven. I don't want to be viewed as the outcast, as the rebel. What makes them think that my faith is any less than their faith?
They care a lot about their family. I believe that. And that's partly why I think they agreed to be a part of this project, because they want to contribute to possibly finding some way to alleviate the pain, you know, to soften some of the conflict, you know, so that their families can come together.
Family Fundamentals premieres in October.
In 1998, Wisconsin Congresswoman Tammy Baldwin became the first openly lesbian or gay person to run for the United States Congress and win. This November, she runs again for her next term. I'm Rachel True, and you're watching In the Life.
I can name about a half a dozen people who have lost their jobs because they come to church here. Our visibility in Dallas, Texas is a dangerous thing, and yet it's something that we really are committed to because we follow someone who says, take up your cross and follow me. And the Cathedral of Hope was founded in 1970. There were no churches at that time in Dallas which would even allow an openly gay or lesbian person to attend, let alone to be a member or be in leadership. And so it started very small, but it grew fairly quickly, and eventually they rented space from the Unitarian Church and then rented their own building and then bought a Church of Christ in about 1978. The Church of Christ they bought was right in the heart of what eventually became the gay and lesbian community. So the church really sort of became the heartbeat of that community there, and every organization practically, especially in the early days in Dallas, came out of that church.
With only 280 members when he became pastor, Reverend Piazza has seen the Cathedral of Hope experience extraordinary growth to become the world's largest church with a gay, lesbian, and transgendered outreach.
Last year, we gave away $1.3 million to the poor and needy. So the congregation really has transformed itself over the last, 14 years. The ironic thing is that in the 14 years that I've been here, we've done over 1,300 AIDS funerals. So this church has grown despite burying hundreds of its members. And I think that it's been a good thing that this church has been here during the time of AIDS. So the growth during that process let me know that when there was a cure for AIDS, or now at least some treatment for AIDS, that the growth really would continue. So we began to look for space. The large churches in the city who were sort of going out of business refused to sell to us. One very large Baptist church that is now out of business said they would burn their building down before they'd sell it to us. So we found some property, and we bought it and built our own building. It is ours. We built it, we designed it, we picked everything in it, every piece of carpet, everything. It is ours. And it also represents us. There are no back walls to the sanctuary, there are no altar rails, there are no fences, there's no symbol in this that doesn't say all are welcome here. After we've been here about 4 years, I looked at it with the congregation and realized that we had outgrown this building. We were already doing multiple services, 3 services a Sunday, and we were turning people away. And so I then had to begin to consider what our options were. I had just returned from a seminar at the Crystal Cathedral, Robert Schuller's church in Garden Grove. And at that place, he said, Philip Johnson, the architect who designed the Crystal Cathedral, is the person who put his ministry on the map. And Philip Johnson, of course, was a gay man. So I came back and I said to the board, what would it be like if we got Philip Johnson to design a building for us that would capture the imagination of people. It would be a symbol for our congregation, for our community.
After flying to New York and convincing Johnson to take on the project, the Cathedral of Hope is now building a new church.
This will be a building unlike any other on the planet, and certainly unlike any other church. It really will be a queer space and a very powerful symbol of a very unique congregation that's large and strong and visible and that is not going anywhere. It's a very strong, you know, solid concrete building that says, this congregation is here to stay. Lesbian and gay folks are here to stay, both in the world and in the church.
Over 1,400 miles away on a busy intersection in Los Angeles, California, the oldest gay and lesbian synagogue in the country is providing a haven for Jews to worship as well.
BCC, Beit Chaim Chadashim, had its origin in the Metropolitan Community Church, and their initials were MCC. And Beit Chaim Chadashim really wanted to align itself with the Metropolitan Community Church because they were the first folks who said, you need a gay temple. We're getting the gay Jews who are coming here because they don't have a place to be. They need a place to pray, a place where all of them is accepted.
How I describe it is I'm a black, white, Romanian Jew. That sort of gives parameters. And I'm also bisexual. And this place was the first synagogue where I just felt like I could be myself. I could just be Melanie.
It's a place where my partner Steve and I can come together, worship together, and express both our affection for one another as well as our love for Judaism.
We are very involved. The children and I come to services every Friday night. Both children have come since they were Shoshi at 3 weeks, Ashira at 4 weeks. We view this, and the children very much view it as extended family. They're completely comfortable in the shul.
This sense of community extends to the physical structure, which was important for providing the proper setting for worship.
And this is an ark, and in it we keep the Torah scrolls. One of our Torah scrolls actually survived the Holocaust in Czechoslovakia. Typically at a synagogue, many, many arks that you see cover the Torahs more completely. This one just has a suggestion of covering. Someone said to me that they understood that design to be in a place like this because we're not in the closet. We're not hiding anything here.
Most of the items in the synagogue were designed or donated by the members of the congregation.
We were given a number of monetary gifts by members of the congregation in order for other members of the congregation to design and create, build these stained glass windows. This was actually a design that was mostly done by David Cheng.
When I was thinking of the design, what came to my mind was this place called House of New Life. If you notice on the end of the window, there's walls, whether those are, some people think they're the Western Wall, it could be the Stone Wall. To me, it's a barrier. Each one of us have our own Egypt that we come out of. So we move from the barrier toward the path, the waves parting, where that's where the path of freedom and liberation is.
What makes BCC unique is that it has continued its pioneering role. It's grown, it's addressed the needs at the time, whether it's been the AIDS crisis by founding something which has now become the Los Angeles Jewish AIDS Services, or whether it's degenderized the language we use in prayer so that we don't refer to God by a male title or pronouns.
The rabbi is generally a guy in most other places, and the cantor is generally a guy, and the president of the synagogue is generally not a Chinese-born, lesbian, Jew by choice woman. That's unusual.
We've learned to kind of model the kind of behavior and the kind of world that we would like to create, that everyone is created in God's image. And that, I think, is hopefully our lasting contribution.
While different from each other, the Los Angeles BCC, Beth Chaim Chadashim, and the Dallas MCC, Cathedral of Hope, both have a common goal of providing a comfortable center of faith for the GLBT community.
It sort of seems to me like if there's a war zone, if there's a GLBT war zone, It's that it starts with, you know, the hot button of God, like God says no. So to have sort of set up your house, you know, right on the front line of God says no and say, you know what, God says yes and we're living here and we're thriving. So by living, first of all, by thriving, by constantly redefining, not actually, it's not even redefining, it's defining in the first place, you know, our place. It's a very powerful thing.
I'm Beth Anthony, and you're watching America's gay and lesbian news magazine, In the Life.
Still to come on In the Life, bouffants on Broadway, out and about with a whole new Betsy Ross, and Harvey Fierstein teases out the vote.
And action.
Do not touch that remote.
But first, In the Life ventures out and about with Joy Cardwell, one of the club scene's brightest stars.
On this episode of Out and About, New Jersey couples fight to justify their love. Modern dance legend Bill T. Jones turns 50. The rainbow flag unfurls in a special exhibit, and the gay games go walkabout.
In an historic court case aiming to legalize marriage for same-sex couples in New Jersey, seven lesbian and gay couples filed a lawsuit against that state last June.
We've been together for 12 years in a loving, committed relationship. And I want to be able to protect Marcy throughout the rest of our lives the same way any other couple does. And we're not able to do that.
They're just fed up. They're fed up with paying first-class taxes and being second-class citizens. And the time is right, the time is now to work for full equality.
Lambda Legal Defense and Education Fund, a legal organization seeking full equality for lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgendered people, has agreed to represent the New Jersey couples.
Their relationships range in duration from 10 years up to 30 years.
There are so many benefits that we cannot get access to because we can't get married. There are healthcare benefits, including insurance. There are tax implications where we pay full taxes, but we don't get the tax benefits of a married couple.
In Vermont, what families have available to them are something called civil unions, which is, in a way, all but marriage. And is still second-class citizenship.
You know, when you've been discriminated against for a very long time, you begin to settle. You begin to settle and you start thinking, you know, domestic partnership, maybe that is enough. Civil unions, you know, maybe that is enough. At least we've come this far. And I think it's a little bit of feeling like maybe you don't deserve it.
I think marriage is just what's fair. It's what's fair and it's what's equal. And we're not asking for one right more, and we're certainly not asking for any rights less. We just want what everybody else has access to, which is marriage.
The new Victory Theater on 42nd Street in New York was recently the scene of a 50th birthday celebration for renowned choreographer Bill T. Jones. Champagne and celebrity co-mingled at the glamorous event.
Let us break bread together on our knees.
We're gathered here tonight to celebrate 50 years of Bill T. Jones, the artist.
The Bill T. Jones Arnie Zane Dance Company has performed across America and in 30 countries. Its repertoire of over 75 works is highly diverse in visual imagery and subject matter, with many containing outwardly gay themes. The evening was highlighted by Jones performing some of his signature works.
Oh, such a perfect day. You just keep me hanging on.
For 20 years, the company has shaped the evolution of dance and contributed to that world's priorities, its methods, and its language.
This past summer, the rainbow flag was the focus of an exhibit at New York's Gay and Lesbian Community Center. It incorporated photography, silk screens, posters, and of course, flags. Gilbert Baker, who assembled the exhibit, created the original gay and lesbian rainbow flag in San Francisco in 1978. With a nod to history, Baker dressed to channel the spirit of Betsy Ross at the June 14th opening celebration.
Always the point of the rainbow flag was to be a little bit of an anti-flag. We took something from nature as opposed to nationalism. So red for life and orange for healing and yellow for the sun, green for nature, turquoise for magic, and blue for serenity, and violet or pansy purple, as I call it, for the spirit. Darling, it was all LSD. We were hippies. It was an organic time then. But I see your true colors shining through. I see your true colors. That's why I love you. So don't be afraid to let them show you. The flag was a great visibility tool. I like to think of the rainbow flag as a direct visibility action.
The flag's greatest visibility action came in 1994 for the 25th anniversary of Stonewall, when a one-mile-long rainbow was carried along the streets of New York.
A flag can't be designed. It has to be torn from the soul of the people. And I think that that's what happened with the rainbow flag. People just loved it.
Flags of many colors from over 70 countries will join the rainbow flag at the Gay Game 6 Sports and Cultural Festival in Sydney, Australia. With 14,000 participants expected from countries as diverse as Bangladesh, Croatia, Fiji, and Rwanda, Gay Game 6 has far surpassed the number of athletes that took part in the 2000 Sydney Summer Olympics. In addition to the numerous sporting venues, the festivities will include 11 cultural events with more than 50 shows and exhibitions. The Sydney Gay Games are also being billed as a political and intellectual gathering, with 7 conferences occurring on topics such as gay marriage and advancing the human rights of gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgender people all over the world.
In 1992, Massachusetts, Althea Garrison became the first openly transgender person to win a seat in any U.S. legislature. She was also a Republican. I'm Dirk Shafer, and you're watching In the Life.
Next, Daniel Carslake takes us behind the scenes to show us just what went into making In the Life's favorite Tony winner a big girl now.
The new musical Hairspray, based on John Waters' film and starring In the Life's own Harvey Fierstein, has brought 1962 Baltimore to 2002 New York City, and it's taken Broadway by storm. Months before the play opened, In the Life went backstage to find out how a predominantly gay creative team transformed an indie classic like Hairspray into a major Broadway musical.
In 1998, producer Margot Lyon was looking for her next Broadway project when she saw John Waters' 1988 film Hairspray, starring newcomer Ricky Lake and Divine.
And my diet pill is wearing off. Tracy, I want you to go to your room and study.
I'm from Baltimore. I'd seen it in 1988, but I wasn't sophisticated enough at that point to appreciate its many virtues. And then about 20 minutes in, I thought, this is it. This is what I want to do.
Once Lyon secured the rights to the property, the first call she made was to the film's writer-director, John Waters.
I was all for it. It had been optioned before, actually. It had been a television show that didn't work, too, a pilot. So I was thrilled, especially when I met the people who were going to do it.
I chose the creative team, beginning with the choice of Mark Shaman to compose the score, who is someone I wanted to work with for many years. When I called him about Hairspray, he said yes.
She called me to see who would I like to work with on lyrics, and I said, truthfully, I would actually like to write them with Scott.
Scott Whitman has been Mark's occasional collaborator and full-time life partner for over 23 years.
I said, you know, Mark, I think this is not a good idea. I said, you know, it's way too fragile a situation to go through the ups and downs of creating a musical. And he said, well, let us just try.
So we sat down and we said, we'll write four songs. And if the tone is right, what you want for the piece, then we'll do it. And it was. So, and those four songs are still in the show. So it's up to right.
I was captivated by them and decided to take the plunge.
As soon as I knew Mark Shaman and Scott were writing music, they did South Park the movie, which is one of my favorite musicals ever. I knew Harvey, I knew his work, I knew everything about him, so I was thrilled. And when I saw Marissa, I thought, God, this is perfect. We need a chubby Ethel Merman.
And being a character actress and doing comedy and being chubby and just fun. It's just there aren't very many things for me, and I never would have imagined that this would come. So it's not even like a once-in-a-lifetime thing. It's like once in like five lifetimes, you know, for me. It's just, it's an amazing thing. Harvey's playing my mom, but I never even think of it as a man playing my mother. It's just Harvey's my mom. Well, the two of us together have really formed a bond. So on stage, it's like so trusting. Like I don't even think that we're doing scenes. It's just, we're just having fun together.
This telephone call came that they're doing a musical of Hairspray and they want to see me. And I said, and I went in and I sang and I sang and I sang. And I mean, I think I must've sang six or seven songs for them. By the time I got home, the call had already come through. There's nobody but you we want. And it's been the journey since.
Lyon hired playwright Mark O'Donnell and Tom Meehan, who had just written the Tony Award-winning book for The Producers, another film-to-stage adaptation. She was also able to lure the pair who helped to adapt the full Monty for the stage, director Jack O'Brien and choreographer Jerry Mitchell.
In this case, also, as with Monty, you try to distill what you think the film is about and preserve that no matter what you do, and I think that's what we're working on right now.
Hairspray is about a big girl with big hair who wins a spot on her local TV dance show and then fights to integrate the show in 1960s Baltimore.
This is a white establishment?
Oh, come on!
Listen, we just came to dance.
That's not fair!
It's a story of outsiders who fight for acceptance, a particularly resonant theme for its gay creators.
Hairspray is not just about hairspray.
Your size, your color, your race, your, you know, your preference, whatever.
It celebrates that in a way.
Yeah, celebrate the eccentricities. And, you know.
And it's short.
In Hairspray, every single person is a hero, is the people that are never heroes or heroines in regular movies. So the outsiders always win in my movies and plays.
John had also written a musical. His movie is a musical, you know, even though per se it isn't, but it all sings and dances. And so it's such a easy to write for. It's so natural.
After 2.5 years of close collaboration between the creative team, the book, the score, and the cast was in place, and rehearsals began in April 2002. Weeks into rehearsal, the entire cast and crew packed up and relocated to Seattle for Hairspray's all-important out-of-town tryout.
It all starts when the curtain goes up in Seattle. In spite of all the work that's been done the last 4 weeks here in New York in rehearsal, in spite of all the pre-production work, in the design, in the cutting of the costumes, and the fitting of them, and all of the elements that we've been trying to put together for the last 8 or 9 months, nothing starts until you get in front of an audience.
It's a big circus. You gotta put it all together. And it's not a lot of time to get it done. So
It's gonna be tough, but we'll make it. We always do.
Well, Mark's role there will be with the orchestra and the music, and then once the performance starts, we'll both be, you know.
Just listen to how the audience is reacting.
Let the audience now tell us what's funny and what works and what doesn't.
I hear rumors are that they like, people give script changes the day of and you rehearse all day and then new choreography, new numbers are put in, and I'm just like, oh, I just think it's perfect right now, so that would be really great if it just stayed.
Many changes were made to the show in Seattle. In fact, this song came out because the creators felt it didn't quite work.
When I was just a little girl, my mother set me straight. She taught me what to say and how to dress and who to hate.
So that was fun because we actually got to sit in a hotel room with a piano and write a song every night, to the right one to fit the space.
The one that we're now previewing here in New York is our third...
The third version of it. Song.
We spent every day in Seattle from 12 to 5 writing. The writers wrote, we restaged, redirected, reshuffled the deck, and tried to get it all our cards in order. So when we came here, we were ready to show everybody what we had.
We were able to learn exactly what we needed to learn out of town with an incredibly enthusiastic audience every night. So that's a sort of ideal situation.
After 2 weeks of rehearsal and 3 weeks of performances in Seattle, the production returned to New York in anticipation of its Broadway opening.
About a week before the show opens, in theory, it will freeze, which means no more changes in blocking or dialogue, so the actors can become confident with what they're doing rather than feel around for which version of the script they're going to be doing tonight.
After 2 more weeks of fine-tuning the show in New York and almost 4 weeks of preview performances, the entire team was ready for their big night.
Well, this is it. 3 years after lead producer Margot Lyon first had the concept of making Hairspray the movie into Hairspray the musical, it all comes down to tonight, opening night on Broadway. How do you think New York will react to Hairspray?
I think New York has already given Hairspray a great big hug.
It's just a dream come true, obviously, as a couple as well. I mean, it's been unbelievable.
How many gay people does it take to put on a musical?
Okay.
Well, at least these two.
By the end of the evening, it was clear that Hairspray was going to be a big hit.
It's really a big compliment to the film and to the work we did 14 years ago, and it's thrilling to see it on stage, and it's a great show. They really did a great job.
It was one of the highlights of my life, I think. I mean, I look back, you don't get many of these in your career.
These are all my dreams, you know? It's quite a ride. Gosh, and it feels like we've been doing the show for months and months and months, and then all of a sudden it's like, oh no, this is it.
According to the Gay and Lesbian Victory Fund, less than half of 1% of America's elected officials are gay or lesbian. Next month, there are gay candidates in elections across the country, including elections in some of the 16 states with no out officials at all. So this is your chance to make a real difference. We need every single one of you to get out and vote. I'm Paris Barclay, and you're watching In the Life.
And finally, in tonight's outtakes, Harvey Fierstein sheds the wig and comes out voting.
Do not touch that remote, even though I am about to discuss the unsexiest subject possible. Pay as much attention as you would if I was talking about that certain Hollywood starlet who just left her hot, hunky husband to run off with his mother. Gotcha. Okay, we're gonna talk about voting. Put down that remote. I'll make this quick, I promise. A few years ago, I was watching one of my favorite comics, George Carlin. Not as cute as he used to be, but who is? Well, old Georgie was talking about how he wasn't going to vote that year. Why should I, he asked, when all the candidates are basically the same and it doesn't really matter who wins any election because nothing ever changes. Well, my mouth hung open. Doesn't matter. Nothing ever changes. But of course, if I were George Carlin, I might feel the same way. George is, after all, a white male Christian heterosexual living in America. What's he got to vote for? He's already got it made.
he's already flush with full protection. Every law on the books was written to protect his job, housing, property, privacy, health benefits, reproductive rights, and his pursuit of happiness. He could even join any branch of the military he pleases, put a full color picture of the person he's dating in his footlocker, and live to kiss, tell, and pursue. But for the rest of us, for all of us who ain't white, male, Christian, heterosexuals, things change. Elections matter. And it is a very big deal who gets in. So I can already hear you moaning. I know that, but Anita Bryan ain't running for office in my district. To you, I say, are you sure? Have you done your homework? And even if you have, you still gotta vote. Even if there is no one running that you think could make a difference to our agenda or our issues, you still gotta get out there and put your two cents in. You must have noticed how every politician of every persuasion brown noses senior citizens. Not a one wants to be seen as anti-Social Security. You know why? It ain't because they got silver-haired mothers. They know that senior citizens show up in huge numbers to vote. Politicians are scared to death of turning that block against them, so they do not mess there. It's the old adage, best defense is a good offense. So, while it may not matter who you vote for on every election day, it still matters that you show up to vote on every election day. And who knows, as long as you're going to the polls, you might just take a look at the ballot, find an issue that could use your good sense backing it up. Voting, kids. It's the one right they haven't tried to take from us. Yet.
I'm John Bartlett. For all of us at In the Life, here in New York's Splashlight Studios, thank you for watching, and we'll see you next month.
Life is funded in part by the H. Van Ameringen Foundation. Additional support provided by the Ford Foundation, the Gill Foundation, the Arcus Foundation, Nebraska AIDS Project, the Pride Foundation, University of Nebraska Medical Center HIV Clinic, the Terry K. Watanabe Charitable Trust, Michael A. Leppin, Orlando Reese and Bill Becker, William J. Resnick, the Jim Stepp and Peter Zimmer Funds of Stonewall Community Foundation, and the annual support of In the Life members like you.